Well, China has around 750 million people who are active users of the internet. It's both an opportunity and a threat for the Chinese Communist Party. On the one hand, they want their citizens to harness the internet's potential for economic growth, but at the same time, they want to curb any potential for social disruption.
The solution has been to institute what's known as the Great Firewall of China, but how do truth and censorship coexist? To help us grapple with this question, we're talking with Fergus Ryan, analyst at the Australia Strategic Policy Institute. He'll be appearing today at an MCA panel in Sydney as part of their Conversation Starters program. Fergus, thanks so much for coming in.
Thanks for having me.
You describe China's censorship as having vague boundaries and being opaque. What do you mean by that?
Well, there was a great saying by a China scholar called Perry Link about 10 years ago, who described the Chinese censorship regime as being like an anaconda coiled in a chandelier above the Chinese internet users. He said it's not like a man-eating tiger or a fire-breathing dragon. It's more something like this anaconda that you know is there and it's very quiet, but it will pounce at any moment. So you don't really know where the red lines are. And the effect of that is that people tend to self-censor because they're not sure exactly when that anaconda is going to pounce.
How is that playing out practically, not just for the people within China, but also for those around as well, for the international community?
Well, we're seeing increasingly as China becomes more powerful and exerts its power beyond its borders, that there is an increasing tendency for people and organizations across many different industries and fields to self-censor. There was a great article in the New Republic this week that talked about this and how it's happening in American think tanks and American universities. Basically, put very simply, as organizations, whether they be universities, businesses, politicians, governments, have more relations with China and are dependent on having an economic relationship with China, China then has a point of leverage over people and organizations and can use that to control their messaging.
What have been your observations when it comes to, I guess, the younger generation, the generation that has been born into the internet age, in terms of how they feel about the censorship in China, and do they even really care?
Well, there's been really great research done on this. A researcher at the University of California, San Diego, called Margaret Powers, has talked about how most people in China aren't even aware that a Great Firewall exists. In fact, only about 30% are aware, and then only 5% have actually gone to the effort of acquiring a VPN or a virtual private network to allow them to jump over the Great Firewall. Another really fascinating study that came out recently by academics at Stanford University and Peking University found that when these VPNs were given to young students, they didn't necessarily go out and seek information that was on that was banned and on foreign websites that isn't normally available in China. However, interestingly, when they were prodded and nudged a little to go to websites like the New York Times Chinese version, they really gobbled up that information and then very substantially changed how they thought about many different important political issues. And then many of them then went on to pay for their own VPN services. So there's not necessarily an understanding that censored information is valuable, but once particularly young people are nudged in that direction, they soon discover that it is actually quite valuable indeed.
Because as we indicated earlier in the introduction, it's a battle between wanting to harness the economic growth that comes with the internet, but also not wanting that potential social disruption that also comes with it. So how do you see that balancing act playing out in the future?
Well, I mean, Bill Clinton famously said in around the year 2000, I think it was, that China trying to control the internet would be akin to trying to nail jello to the wall. And at the time, it seemed like that was quite a wise thing to say. But what we have seen, unfortunately, is that China has been able to use legal and regulatory means technical means and also ideological means to really control the internet. So they've been able to really bell the cat in that way.
And they've actually become an inspiration to other countries who want to do the same thing, haven't they?
That's the really scary thing, I think, particularly in the world today where we're seeing different countries worry about the ability of other countries and state actors to influence their politics and elections. There's this heightened sense that we need to do something about controlling the internet more. And there is a very real possibility that a lot of countries will look to the Chinese model and think, well, they've got it sorted out, why don't we do that? I think that, however, for liberal democracies, we really need to figure out a different way of dealing with these problems, a way that means that we stick to our principles.
So I was going to say, how should Australia, and particularly the Australian government, be responding to this from China?
Well, I mean, we've seen last week the ABC, the channel that we're currently on, was banned in China. And Prime Minister Scott Morrison's response to that was something along the lines of, China is a sovereign country, what they do in their borders is their business. And I can understand why the Prime Minister said that, but it was an unfortunate choice of words because the main ideological concept that China uses to make sense of its censorship regime is a concept called cyber sovereignty. And what Prime Minister Scott Morrison said plays directly into that concept. And the concept is really just an excuse for their censorship regime.
Fergus Ryan, we'll have to leave it there. Thank you so much for coming in this morning.
Thanks for having me.